going to start today. We're going to worship together in page 322. 322, my sins are blotted out, I know. 322, 322.
What a wondrous message in God's word. My sins are blotted out, I know. If I trust in His redeeming blood, my sins are blotted out, I know. My sins are blotted out, I know. My sins are blotted out, I know. They're buried in the depths of the deeper sea. My sins are blotted out.
Father, we are thankful for this beautiful day. Thank you for your word, which you have allowed us, given us the privilege to open it this day. Not only that, but the Spirit has given us understanding. We ask, Father, that you aid us at this crucial moment in which we have come together. We desire to exalt the Lord Jesus Christ, to sanctify our hearts. But Father, we cannot do those things on our own strength. We need, Father, the blessing of the Spirit. We need, yes. Father, the Son that intercedes for us. Father, that His petition that is never denied come before you at this moment. For Lord, we desire our songs that we take on and everything that we do is in order and is for the honor and glorification of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we desire fruit. We desire, Father, to be fruitful saints. And therefore, we pray that you will allow us, Father, to be a blessing to one another. And as we have met together, that we prepare, that you aid us in preparing to receive the message you have for us. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, amen, amen. And amen. We'll go to page 394. 394, the solid rock. 394.
All other ground is safe.
page 345, when we find that, just remembering to pray for sharing in the finances and all that stuff. And so just pray for that. 345, grace greater than our sin.
Thank you. Oh, there's nothing like being asked to preach after you sing a song like that. Yeah. Boy, you're liable to get a boatload this morning. Wonderful song, wonderful song. Sometimes you get lost in the songs. You know, the word and the music, when they're scriptural, they go together. What a rejoicing that brings to my heart, and be able to sing it with all my heart. You ever get to singing a song and you find some words that don't seem to match the scripture, you kind of stumble through it a little bit, a little hard to throw your heart into it? Well, not so this morning. Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. We've been in the book of Romans for a long time. And you know, some preachers, they like to preach on topics. Others, when they get to teaching theological things, they teach systematic theology. You know, you pick a subject and you preach through that, and you teach that subject, then you move to another subject. Not here. We do biblical theology. In other words, we preach the theology of the Bible. And as we study the Bible, we preach whatever theology is in that passage of Scripture. And we've touched on nearly probably every theological subject that you can, and we're only up to chapter 10. The only thing we haven't got to is eschatology. We haven't gotten there. And I don't know that we'll ever get there in the book of Romans, because that wasn't the main concern. The theme of the book of Romans is the righteousness of Christ. It is the righteousness of Christ. And we're in that section where we're looking at the way by which faith comes to men. This is confusing in the heart of some people. How do men come to faith? Some think that we probably have some internal generator that generates the faith. And that's not true. It's a gift of God. So let's go to Romans chapter 10 and let's begin reading at verse 13. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How shall they call on him in whom they've not believed? And how shall they believe on him of whom they've not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah saith, Lord, who hath believed our report? So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. But I say, have they not heard? Yes, verily, their sound went out into all the earth, and their words unto the ends of the world. Now we're going to be doing a word study through this section, because in the English, it is not able to express all that is in the Greek in this passage. And hopefully we can expand it and make it full and make it so that it becomes really something meaningful and important to us. Father, I want to thank you for your blessings to us today. We ask that you'll pour out a blessing upon us as we study the word, that you'd fill us with thy grace and with thy mercies. Father, that you would cause us to be able to understand, to learn of the good things and of the rich things and of the wonderful things that are found in thy word. Father, may we not let anything slip away, but Father, that we might treasure the things that are found in the word of God, that we might be blessed and encouraged and strengthened, and that we might grow in the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we ask this in our Savior's blessed name. Amen. Now we have been looking for about four Sundays in verses 13 through 15. And we've seen the progression of the gospel and its effect. We start with the man that calls upon the name of the Lord. It tells in verse 13, it says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And how many evangelists get up and preach just that verse and leave it without the context in which it's given? And this is a real shame today in the pulpits of America, is that we preach a verse and the Bible says, he tells us to preach the word of God. And so we preach a verse and we extrapolate from that verse totally out of the context in which it's given. Shame on preachers that do that. Really a shame. It says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord. And we get this big whosoever. That means whoever will. And you know, the Bible doesn't say whosoever will. It says whosoever believeth. The only place where it says whosoever will is in the Old Testament in relationship to the law. Whosoever will obey the law. An action of the will. But it's whosoever believeth. And in this case, it is whosoever shall call. But how does one call? And when does one call? Well, we go to the next verse. And it says, how shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? So belief, faith, conversion comes before they call on the name of the Lord. And then it says they shall be saved. This is not talking about the immediate results of the regeneration of the Holy Spirit. This is a future tense, which he's referring to when Christ shall come back and we shall experience the fullness of our salvation. That's what it's talking about there. There is that belief. They have believed in the Lord. They have trusted in the Lord. And because they have trusted on the Lord Jesus Christ, they then call upon the Lord who shall save them in their completeness in the resurrection. Notice it doesn't say shall have eternal life, because they have eternal life, present tense. But they shall experience the fullness of their salvation in the resurrection. So we've looked at this and we've been looking at these verses in their fullness. How shall they call on him unless they believe? And he believes the gospel message preached to him by gospel ministers. For then it continues on. And how shall they believe on him whom they've not heard? So there is the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we spent some time looking at what the gospel is. Because there's a lot of people, a lot of churches, a lot of preachers who no longer preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. They preach a works type gospel. You have to do this in order to get life and be born from above. We don't believe in works. We believe in grace. We believe that God saves whomsoever he wills. It's just that simple. That's what God does. That's what the scriptures proclaim. So he hears the word of God. He believes what he has heard. His faith is operational in him by the Spirit of God. And he places his faith in what he has heard, that is in the gospel of Jesus Christ. How shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? And we spent last week looking at the sending of preachers and how that happens, and how that it is not a church that ordains a man to the gospel ministry. It is God that ordains a man to the gospel ministry, and it is the church that sends him. If you don't think so, just go over and read Acts chapter 13. And it says that God called Paul and Barnabas to a work. And then the church sent them. And the word sent means divorced. Among some of our Baptists, they teach that there's some kind of an attachment involved there, that the church now has power over that person that they just sent into the gospel ministry. And they don't. It says they divorced him. They separated him, Paul and Barnabas, and they sent them on their way into the gospel ministry to do the work that God had appointed them to do. And then they came back and they told the church what work God had been doing them. But the church back at home there in Antioch didn't have to vote on anything that Paul and Silas did. That's the way some of these our Baptist preachers preach and teach in their churches. And that's too bad, because that's not what the scriptures say. We're kind of an old Baptist church. In case you don't know what kind of a Baptist are, we're old. We get pretty close to being primitive. Primitive doesn't mean that we're old. It just means our doctrine is old, that the faith is old, that the Lord's churches have been around from old. All right, let me move on. I've lost my place in my notes, if I have any. Now, the preacher is faced with a glaring question in our text. Why do not more people call upon the name of the Lord? Why do so few believe on the Lord Jesus, the heavenly man, the Savior of the world? Because what does it say in our text here? But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah said, Lord, who hath believed our report? We've gone out and we've preached. They've heard, but they don't believe. They don't obey. How come? You see, there's a mystery here that Paul reveals. And you know that most preachers do not know what the scriptures say about this. They don't understand it. And I'm not saying that I'm a specially gifted preacher. I just know what the old preachers preached. I could study the Word of God and found out what it said. But you know what? Preachers a lot of times are too lazy to do a word study in the original languages. And I'm no expert in any of it. I'm glad I've got a whole bunch of experts on my Bible program to teach me. One of the most important things, kids, get this. How many of you like grammar? How many of you like English grammar? No hands raised. How many of you adults like English grammar? I'll tell you what, if you're going to study the scriptures, you need to start grasping something about grammar. And you're going to have to learn something a little bit more because we don't have... How many of you ever heard of the middle voice in the English language? There isn't any. Anyone ever heard of the aorist tense? Some of you probably have heard of that. You know what it is? We don't have it in English. So we need to learn some of these things. And I try to help. See, this dear brother's a preacher. And I try to help him. I do try to help him. Because I want him, when God calls him away from here, and he goes and does the ministry, I want him to know how to study. I want him to... Well, somebody just set off an alarm. I've preached that loud before and have never done that before.
Yeah.
Well, we'll just have to do the best we can then. This will be nice. I'll be on the recording. You just get wrapped up in your message and all of a sudden you get an alarm. Now I forgot where I left off. But the glaring question, why is it so few believe the word of God preached? Oh, I remember where I was. I'm easily distracted, so I apologize for that. Of course, that's probably distracting to the rest of you too as well. So, got to get back into it.
Well, there's probably a button on the alarm that you just silenced.
I don't know if there's a... there's probably a code that you have to put into it. Probably a code. Anyways, we'll get over that. That's the first time that's ever happened to us. All right. Anyways, let me move on. I'll just move on to my notes, the next notes, because I forgot. I preach what's in my notes, and I preach what's not in my notes. So if I'm on something that's not in my notes, something like that happens, I don't know where I'm going. Others see these verses right here as a mandate to get people saved with a ministry or with an quasi-evangelist. You talked about them this morning. You didn't know I was going to preach on them, did you? Oh, I remember. what I was talking about you, wasn't I? About being a preacher and being... he needs to be equipped for the gospel ministry. He needs someone who's going to teach him the things that are found in God's Word that other preachers won't. If he goes to Bible school, if you went off to Bible school, you would not have learned as much theology as you've got listening to us go through the book of Romans. I can guarantee you that. You know why? Because I got a theology degree back on the wall, and I know how much theology I got. Not as much as I'm getting from the book of Romans. I'll tell you that right now. But you need to know what to preach when you get out there from the book and what the book says. And we don't preach anything unless we find it in this book. We don't practice anything unless we found it in this book. And that is a period at the end. We think that we believe the book, and the book ought to dictate everything that we believe and everything that we practice. And you ought to believe that if you're God's children, right? Anyways, others see these verses as a mandate to get people saved, and we have ministries of quasi-evangelists preaching across the world, extracting conversions by manipulation of the mind and the scriptures. And they go everywhere preaching what they call the gospel, and then you get people coming forward. You know, the people coming forward are a validation for them that they're doing the gospel work. And yet many of them manipulate the minds of people with psychology. And you know what? It happens all the time. I remember the Ledbetters. Remember the Ledbetters? There was supposed to be a Christian singing group, which they held at the school. And we went to the school cafeteria, where they got up and they performed. And one of the things that they did was they're singing their old sad country song, which is a gospel song, or a country gospel people. And they got out their handkerchiefs, started dabbing the eyes. They were psychologically manipulating the people to get them worked up emotionally to get some kind of a response to their singing. And if you watch carefully what these preachers do, they will manipulate an audience. I remember going to a Baptist church, and they had a special speaker there, one who's going to do a revival. And he got up and he took the word of God and he quoted a verse from the scriptures. And he started to work that verse a little bit and talked a little bit about it. But then you know what he did? He started telling us a story. And he told us a sad story. And then when he finished up with that sad story, he moved into another sad story. And then he moved to another sad story. And I started watching, and people started getting emotionally worked up, and tears were coming to their eyes as these sad stories were told about someone who came so close but died, or whatever it was. And when he was done, he had half the church up at the very, very front on their knees asking Jesus in their heart. It happens all the time. You ever have an evangelist come into your church and half the church members are coming up to the front getting saved again? Weren't they saved once? What is going on here besides a manipulation of the people by the evangelist? Manipulating the minds of lifeless souls, thinking that they're the voice of God by which men are converted and call upon the Lord. These boasts of having great numbers of converts that come to the faith, yet at the end of the so-called revival week, when they leave town, their so-called converts go back into the life and the lifestyle that they said that they repudiated by coming to Christ. How many of them ever make it into the baptistry? How many of them ever become members, solid members of gospel churches? They don't. They go back to their former way of life, never having repented, but believe in their religious experience as their salvation. You see, they had a religious experience and they believed that they were saved. And yet they're still as lifeless after their so-called salvation as it was when they walked in the door. You see, there's a lot of difference between having a religious experience and true gospel conversion. What is boasted as revival is reversion. The preacher thinks that he's a great evangelist with many conversions under his belt, but his success, he's successful because he's booked out for the next 3 years. You know, he must be a successful evangelist. He's booked out 3 years. We're just very lucky as a church to have him here. You don't know how lucky you are that we were able to get this evangelist, this preacher, this revivalist in for you. Count your lucky stars. The preacher thinks he's a great evangelist with many conversions under his belt, but he's successful because, you know, he measures success by the fact that he's been booked out for the next 3 years, but in his path, he leaves a wake of dead souls that believe that they're now Christian. How many people are going to churches thinking that they are saved because they had an experience, they've received Jesus, and they go to these churches by the churches are literally packed full. And they get their worldly music out, and they sing their worldly songs, and they sway back and forth. And, you know, it's like I said a couple Sundays ago, you know, the Holy Spirit shows up when the worship team starts singing. You know, because, I mean, you can't worship without a worship team. The Holy Spirit doesn't show up until you start singing and swaying back and forth. Do you know that all that is a manipulation of the audience? Now, let me ask you, how much of a demand would there be if the evangelist never gave an invitation? Walk forward, raise your hands. Coming forward never saved a man. Praying a prayer never saved a man. The Pharisee prayed, didn't he? Says, Lord, I'm sure glad I'm not like that old, what was he? He was a scallywag, a tax collector, a dog. Publican was the word. Lord, I'm sure glad I'm not like him. If no one came down the aisle, as is a supposed evidence of his calling, would he be invited back to preach? Do you know how many invitations I get to preach in other churches? None. Why? I don't give an invitation. I don't need someone coming down the aisle to validate my ministry. God has called me to preach, and I will preach the word of God, and it's God's business to save people, and he can save you right where you sit. You don't have to come down to an aisle to validate within yourself whether or not you've been saved. You don't have to come down and talk to the preacher who says, pray this little prayer. You know, Lord, I'm a sinner. Please forgive me. And I repent and you're saved. That's not the work of God. When God works in your heart and there is true repentance, you will know it. You will have no choice but to fall on your knees, cry out and weeping to God that he would have mercy on your soul. Amen. Would that man be booked out for the next 3 years? No, and you know, churches are just as culpable in the propagation of this pseudo ministry because they invite them in. You just read it this morning. What did Paul tell Timothy, the pastor of that church? Do the work of an evangelist. The work of evangelism is the work of the ministry. It is a pastoral work. And that's what an evangelist is. Listen, these men who are supposedly so gifted and so capable in the harvest of souls Why are they not out establishing New Testament churches? Why are they not? Why do they only come to a church that invites them to come over and preach? How come they're not out there going door to door, evangelizing, giving the gospel, and having people saved and establish a church or churches? Why don't they just pick a place and go? They're so gifted in evangelism, right? Evangelism is church work, is what it is. See, they're not interested in starting churches. They would rather just go to an established church. And do you know why they want to go to an established church? Because the churches are their bread and butter. That's how they get paid. The church just goes and gives them a love offering. And that's why they go from church to church to gather love offerings. They preach the same sermon across the entire nation, everywhere they go. Or they have a repertoire of 3 or 4, maybe 5 sermons. And they preach what they have. That's a shame. That's a shame. I say, if a man is called to do evangelistic work, let him go, like Paul, like Silas, and to a city and set up a tent shop to support himself and preach and establish a church. In my honest opinion, I do not believe that evangelism and evangelists as practiced in America is biblical. It's not, doesn't meet the, what the Bible says. Men make a living traveling from church to church, preaching their wares, and in some cases, snake oil. I've heard some of these preachers like, what? Where did you get that? You ever heard a preacher talk about kicking the devil? I heard a preacher talk about kicking the devil. Where do you get that? Let me regress a little. I kind of went on a little diatribe there about some of these preachers. I'm supposed to be preaching the word this morning. We remember that Paul is addressing a church. It is the church at Rome. He's not writing to Christians in general, like a lot of people want to say. It is to a church, a specific church, a specific message to this church, which consisted both of Jewish believers and Gentile believers. And chapters 9 through 11 are all of one subject. That is, we had other subjects that were gathered together, but 9 through 11 is of all one subject, and is God's sovereignty in dispensing grace upon all kinds of men, not exclusively Israelites. Amen. And that's what these three chapters are about. That while Israel had a distinct advantage over the Gentile, they rejected as a nation God as their father and Jesus as the Messiah. The theme of this chapter has been the righteousness that comes by faith, and with that comes the preaching of the gospel. The righteousness that comes by faith. That's what this whole chapter's about. Now, there's also a question of obedience. Look at verse 16. But they have not all obeyed. Now, I imagine all of the kids here all obey every single time mom or dad has told them to do something. Right? Always obey. No. It says, verse 16, but they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Esaias saith, Lord, who hath believed our report? First, we must answer some questions like, who is the they in the text? We don't understand this until we know who the they is. So that's part of English, knowing who is he is speaking of. One of the things I always tell people, when you study the scriptures, when you read the scriptures, ask some questions. Who, what, when, where, how, and why? There might be another one in there. But you gotta, if you don't ask those questions, guess what? You lose the context of the scriptures. We need to ask, who's he talking to? What is he talking to them about? Why is he talking to them? How is he talking to them? Where is it that he's at? We lose track of those things. We'll lose what's the scripture speaking. So we see that in verse 14, it says, they, how shall they call on whom they have not believed? We are talking about those who have heard the gospel and who have believed, those who call upon the name of the Lord. In verse 15, they, it says, and how shall they preach? That is the preachers. How shall they preach except they be sent? And in verse 16, they are those who have heard the preaching, but they have not all obeyed the gospel. They are those who have heard, but don't obey. So they are all those who have heard the preaching of the gospel, but not obey its calling to repentance and faith. The what does the Bible say that Jesus came and did? He preached the king, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Did he preach the gospel? Absolutely. Did John the Baptist preach the gospel when he said, repent, the kingdom of heaven is at hand? And we preach the gospel. The Bible says that we're to preach repentance towards God and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. But not all obey it. I want to mention first the universality of the gospel. From the word of God, we know that Christ and his disciples went up and down the land of Israel and preached the gospel. Did they not? They went into the towns and the villages all through Israel and preached. They did it in the Jerusalem area. They went up into Galilee and they preached to the Jews up in Galilee. They even preached to a few Samaritans, but basically the Jewish population is where he went to in his life and his ministry. And then after the rise of persecution in Jerusalem, the disciples were scattered about throughout the whole of the Roman Empire, the known world. They were scattered throughout, spreading the gospel, and churches were established everywhere. And I found this was really exciting in my reading this last week. Do you know that there was a church planted in Wales, England in 63 AD during the life of Paul? And that two people are mentioned in the Holy Scriptures that were Welshmen, Pudens and Claudia, were from Wales, England, were part of the Roman. In fact, they said they were of Caesar's household. And they came from Wales and were in Rome at the time that Paul was in his house when he was locked up and jailed and in his own hired house. Pudens and Claudia came and Paul taught them and they went back up into Wales and there was a church established in 63 AD in Wales, England. Well, it was Wales then, it wasn't England. Well, England and the country of Wales were two different places in that time. And you know, for 600 years, that church, those churches there flourished, had a wonderful, blessed time, no persecution at all for 600 years. Then it changed and persecution came. And they were slaughtered by the thousands, if not hundreds of thousands. And the Black Mountains of Wales became the Welsh people's Piedmont compared to the Waldenses. The Waldenses were in the valleys of the Piedmont. Well, the Black Mountains became the hiding places of the Baptists there in Wales. The oldest Welsh church, or the oldest church in England, was found at Hillcliff. 1300s, there was a gravestone there. They met earlier than 1300, living underground, nearly inaccessible. But they were there. See, the Lord sustains his people. But the universality of the gospel. From the word of God, we know that Christ and his disciples went up and down the land. The gospel spread throughout the Roman Empire. And the establishment of the church in Wales in 63 was because, the Romans tried to invade Wales and couldn't do it. The Welshmen drove them out. They lost their war. And so they made peace with the people in Wales. That's why they were under the protection of Rome, 600 years undisturbed. So it is also true that while thousands heard the gospel, very few believe its message. It is true throughout history, millions have heard the gospel, but in comparison, very few have believed on the Lord Jesus. Oh, that many are called Christians, but very few believe and obey the gospel. You see, there's a lot of people that call themselves Christians, don't they? But you know what? You don't see any difference in their lives. You don't see anything where the music is the same. They go to the same places. They dress the same way. They believe the same things, but they don't believe what the Word says. And if you take to them and says, you know, this is what God says about this, they don't care. Their opinions count more than the Word of God, but they're Christians. I think the devil's in that. While heavens do not speak of the gospel per se, they do declare the glory of God and are a manifest witness of the eternal Godhead. In Romans 1:20 says, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. No man has an excuse before God, because the heavens declare God's glory. And the firmament showeth his handiwork. And we're going to get over there to Psalm 19. Matter of fact, Psalm 19 right now says, day unto day utters speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. No excuse for a man. A man can't say, I didn't know. No, look into the heavens, because they declare God's glory. Look at the trees. Look at the grass. Look at the birds. Look at everything around you, and it shows the glory of God. But even in the light of such knowledge, instead of being driven to worship the Creator, Romans 1 tells us they change the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like unto corruptible man. Corruptible. You know what the word corruptible means? Decaying. Decayed man. You are nothing but decayed in your flesh. So, but I'm not dead. Oh, spiritually, people are dead. But they're corrupt. They are decayed. There is absolutely no good thing found in man. The scripture says the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? No one can even possibly know the depth of their depravity. One of the tenets is we believe in absolute depravity. A lot of churches say they believe in absolute depravity. I believe it because the scriptures declare it to be so. They change into corruptible man, into birds, into four-footed beasts, and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. Who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshiped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. God has from the very beginning of creation left a witness upon the earth, left a gospel message upon the earth. Adam, for 830 years, preached the gospel, and a need for sacrifice was taught to Adam when God slew an animal to clothe him. And then when Seth, we know it because Seth and Abel, remember, Seth brought an appropriate sacrifice, a lamb, and I'm sorry, not Seth and Abel, Seth and Cain. Cain and Abel. Seth came after, sorry. Abel and Cain. You see, I'm not a perfect preacher. I get up here and I forget the order of things. But you got Cain and Abel. Abel brought the sacrifice of a lamb. But Cain brought of the ground, which was not what God told him. And what did God tell Cain? He says, Cain, your offering will be accepted if you'll do right. But he would not do right, and he killed his brother. He murdered his brother. 830 years, Adam preached and declared the gospel and taught Adam when he was expelled from Eden. Then it says Enoch, the seventh from Adam, had this testimony that he pleased God and God took him, for he was not. In other words, Enoch loved the Lord so much and walked so closely with the Lord. He had this testimony that he pleased God, that God just literally took him out of the earth. He didn't have to die. And then Noah. Noah preached the gospel for 100 years in the building of the ark. How many people were saved from the flood? 8 souls. 100 years of preaching that God was going to judge the world and men needed to repent, but they didn't believe him. They considered him a fool building an ark out there. And every soul perished, saved 8. Then we get over to, it was a Gentile king and priest that Abraham gave tithes to. Melchizedek. And Jethro, the father-in-law of Moses, a Kenite. He wasn't an Israelite. He was a Kenite. He was a Canaanite, a Kenite. As priest, offered a burnt offering, and Aaron with the elders of Israel partook in the offering and the sacrificial feast. And prominence was given to Jethro over Aaron. Thus, for the second time, a priesthood was recognized beyond the limits of Israel. God has always had a witness in the earth concerning himself and salvation for men by faith. It's God's business whom he saves. We have no control over that. It's God's business. Now, next week, I'm going to pick up on the universality of the gospel does not bring universal obedience or salvation. Well, the gospel is heard. Well, it's demonstrated. Well, it's seen. It doesn't bring universal salvation. And then we're going to look at verse 17, a case for hearing. Because it says, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. What does that mean? Does that mean that one reads the scripture, that's how we get saved? Does that mean that when the preacher preaches, that's how one gets saved because he heard it? What is this hearing that is talking about in verse 17? This is going to be exciting because we're going to get into a little word study right there. We're going to find out because we only have one word in the English for word, and that's word. It's more than that in the Greek. And we're going to look at this with a little more detail. Because how does faith come to a man? And you know what? When this is opened up to us, when we come to realize the greatness and the grandness of this, we realize that we are saved by grace and that we had nothing to do with it. You know, a lot of people think that they had something to do with their salvation. Not a thing. Not a thing. It's grace. You can't work for it. You're not worthy of it. You can't do a thing to get saved. What happens after? We're talking about conversion. We're talking about regeneration. There's nothing you can do to be born again. You know, that's the work of God. What happens after you're born again? Then there's some things that come that we do. We believe. And we'll look closely at the scriptures. You know, preachers don't like preaching this. You know why they don't like preaching it? Because the people don't want to hear it. And because they don't believe it themselves. You see, they want to make it a work of man. Man, and that's natural. You know, it's a natural thing for man to want to do something to get. Nobody likes something just given to them, whether they deserve it or not, and we don't deserve it. We feel like we have to do something to earn it. That there's some action that we need that's on our part that we need to take. And when we learn that there's nothing that we have that we can give to the Lord, we don't even have faith unless God gives it to us. You can't believe. You know, people say, well, wait a minute, I don't know about that. Well, we sing that song where You know, it only takes a spark to get a fire going, and then we sing another song where it talks about, you know, there's a spark in our heart, and then the winds of the gospel come and they fan that spark. You mean there's a spark of faith in every one of us? Do you know that's what preachers preach and teach? But you know what? It's not in the scripture. It says not all men have faith. There's no spark of life. Life is given from above. And when God gives that life, you are born again. You're born anew. But God is the source of all life. Be it physical life or spiritual life, God is the author of all life. And nothing that you do or I do can make you have life. It is God that gives you life. That's exciting. Has God given you life? If you have trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ, you are assured that you have the life of God in you. Because the Spirit that is given to us cries out, Abba, Father, does it not? Daddy, Daddy, do we not call upon the Lord and say, Dad, my dear Father, my Lord, my Savior? That's what you do when you have life from above. And we're going to see that. There's so much to learn coming up. There's always so much to learn. But I'm going to finish here because I don't want to keep you all day. I could, but I'm not going to. All right? Father, thank you for being so good and merciful to us, blessing us with heavenly blessings in heavenly places. And Father, as we study, as we dig in, as we learn the truth that's in Christ, oh, Father, we might grow and be nurtured in the faith of Christ. And I ask for your blessings upon us, your blessings upon our visitors today, the Olivers, for your glory and for your praise. In the Savior's name, amen.